Dad, you should see this place. There's a huge flattened area right in the middle of the room. Looks like at least two of them have been sleeping here.
Hey, look over there in the corner.
Oh, wow!
Well, now we know what they had for dinner last night. Put me on speaker.
Got it.
Dad?
Jerry, what did you find?
It's a fully stripped deer carcass, all the way down to the bones. They certainly don't leave any leftovers, that's for sure.
Hey, you two haven't set foot inside, have you?
No, not yet.
Well, don't. You go tromping around inside there, and they'll know you've been there, and they'll never come back again.
But we've already walked around to the outside of the cabin. So what do we do now?
Get as far away from that cabin as possible before they...
Uh-oh.
Oh my God, that's loud!
Harry, Emma, what's going on?
Well, if I have it figured right, the sheets have been changed, the floor has been vacuumed, and it's check-in time at the Bigfoot Inn.
I can hear them, but I can't see them.
Isn't that the way it always goes?
Ah! Dad, they're throwing rocks at us now!
I don't think this one's quite as friendly as the others we've met.
You think? They just threw another one. I've never had one act like this towards me before.
Just like I've said, there's nice ones and mean ones.
So what do we do?
Don't either one of you move. Just stay there.
Stay here? Well, I don't know about you, but to me that sounds just a little counterproductive to living a long life.
Well, what else are you gonna do? Going inside is useless because they know how to get in. You can't outrun them. You can't hide. The only thing you can do is just stay right there and stay still.
But those rocks are coming pretty close to us, and they're big.
Emma, look. There, at the edge of the trees. There he is.
Dad, we see him. He just came out of the trees. He's about 100 feet away.
And he's getting closer with every stride. I told you not to wear that perfume, but did you listen? No.
He's getting closer. He looks mean. What do you think he wants?
I don't know. Maybe a refund on his room?
He's almost here. Oh, God. I never thought it would end like this. I never thought that... Wait. There's another one running out of the trees behind him.
Oh, my God. Look at the size of that one. He's got to be at least a head taller than the other one. Look at him go. He's headed right for the first one coming up behind him.
Wow!
Oh my God, did you see that?
He blindsided him and slammed him from behind and knocked him clear to the ground. Now he's holding him down with one knee on his chest and giving him what for?
I've never seen anything like this in my life!
He is really laying it on him.
Yeah, I can hear him from here.
Now he's gotten off of him. He's letting him get up, and the one who was coming after us is limping away. Headed back to the forest. I can't believe what I've just seen.
Now the other one is turning to look at us and walking this way. But this one has a completely different feel to him, Dad. I don't feel threatened by him at all.
Neither do I. He's totally peaceful.
He's getting closer. About 30 feet away now. 20 feet. Jeez, he's enormous. He's got to be 9 feet at least. Okay, he's stopping. He's looking right at us and...
I saved you because you have both been friendly to my people. But you must go from this place. Do not return again. An evil event took place here ages ago. Those of my people who dwell here are unfriendly. They have been outcast and rejected by the others. It is not safe for you to be here. Go now.
Boy, this mind-speak stuff is amazing. It's almost as if he was actually speaking it out loud. His message was definitely crystal clear. Get out and stay out. Emma, did you get all that? Emma? Emma? I guess she did.
Bigfoot Research Lab, Jonathan Daltin speaking.
Good morning, Professor. This is Charlene Heinz.
Good morning, Charlene. How'd you and Ross sleep last night?
Oh, wonderful. We had a lovely dinner and turned in about 9:30 last night and slept like a couple of babies.
Well, that's good to hear. So what's going on?
Well, I know I said we'd be there 8 sharp, but we got a call early this morning from one of our business associates back home, and they need to have an emergency meeting with us today. It's scheduled for 9 this morning, but I'm not too sure how long it's going to take. The point is, we're not going to be able to make it there to the lab this morning until probably much later.
That's perfectly all right, Charlene. As it turns out, Jerry and my daughter Emma ended up having to take a short trip out into the forest to check out an old abandoned cabin. So it all worked out for the best anyway.
Oh, well, that makes me feel a lot better. At least we're not holding all of you up this morning.
It's no problem at all. You'll get here when you get here.
Thank you, Professor. I'm sure we'll be there sometime today. I'm just not sure when yet. These meetings can take anywhere from an hour to all day.
That's okay. Just give me a call when you're ready to come on over, and I'll make sure to gather all the troops together and be ready when you get here.
Thank you, Professor. I'll be sure to do that. You have a good day, and we'll see you later.
Okay, Charlene. We'll talk at you soon.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Emma, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm just trying to absorb what we just saw back there. I never dreamed I'd see two Sasquatch rolling around on the ground in a knockdown, drag-out fight.
Not exactly what you were expecting to find at the cabin, huh?
Hardly. And now that we've been told to leave and never come back, I'm not sure what I'm going to do about the Jed Cooper story.
Is it really that important for you to solve it? I mean, it's been unknown for over a century. What's the harm in allowing it to go unknown a little longer?
I don't know. It's just in my blood to solve mysteries, I guess. When I'm faced with questions about something, it's like I'm obsessed with finding the answers. Jerry, what are you doing?
I'm pulling over. I think we really need to talk about all this, and it's going to take a lot longer than the time it would take to get back to the lab.
Am I in some sort of trouble?
No, it's nothing like that. Now, I totally understand why you feel like you need to pursue this. I'm the same way with solving problems. It drives me crazy if I can't figure something out. But maybe in your case, something or someone is telling you to back off and leave this one to someone else. I mean, let's take a step back and look at what's happened to you in the last few days. First, you were almost swallowed alive by the earthquake, but you escaped that. Then, just now, you and I were both trapped by an angry, hateful Sasquatch who could have killed us both with one hand. But we were both rescued out of that as well. And in both cases, you were seeking answers to the death of Jed Cooper. It just seems to me that someone somewhere doesn't want the truth to be known about all this. You've been extremely lucky to get out with your life still attached on 2 different occasions. Are you really sure you want to try for 3?
Yeah, I get it. But what about the old saying, the 3rd time's the charm?
Yeah, well, there's another old saying, 3 strikes and you're out. Emma, please give up on this. The clues are all too obvious. You've been lucky twice. Please don't tempt fate with a 3rd try. When you get to the end of your life, what difference is it going to make if you know the answer or not? Please. Let it go.
But it goes against everything in my DNA. It's not that easy.
Well, let me see if I can make it a little easier for you. You're Dad's natural daughter by birth. And Dad told me recently that if it weren't for the fact that he got too busy, he would have adopted me. But even though it isn't all official and legal-like, with the way he basically helped my mom to raise me clear back to when I was knee-high to a grasshopper, and the way he became a father figure to me, I might as well be his son. All it would have taken was his signature and a judge's approval, and it would have been totally legal and binding. So that means you and I coulda, woulda, and shoulda been brother and sister all along. So even though there's no blood relation between us, I still feel a very deep connection to Dad because of the history we have together. And at the same time, I also feel that very same deep connection to you.
Oh, Jerry.
You see, I was an only child. So growing up, I didn't have the luxury of a sibling. Someone I could, you know, do kids stuff with, argue with, play practical jokes on. Someone I could defend if someone else attacked them. I didn't get the chance to do any of that.
Neither did I.
Yeah, that's right. You're an only child, too. So you, more than anybody else, know exactly what I'm talking about.
I sure do.
I mean, a month ago, I didn't even know you existed. But now, my entire life has changed because of you. Now I have a sister to care about. So the one thing I don't want to see happen is for you to be taken out in some kind of unnecessary situation that could have been avoided altogether. You just came into my life, and I don't want to lose you. Because, Emma, I... Oh my God, I can't believe I've actually been given a chance to say this.
It's okay. You can say it.
Emma. My dear sister. I love you.
I love you too, brother.
Hey, what's happening, Daddy-O?
Daddy-O? You've been sniffing your car wax again, haven't you, son?
Nope, I'm just a happy, happy, happy man.
Well, who turned up your flame?
I just had a really good talk with your daughter, my sister.
Your sister? How do you figure that? And speaking of Emma, where is she? You didn't leave her up there at the old Cooper cabin, did you?
Leave her up there? Are you kidding? I would never do that to someone I love. I reserve that kind of thing for people I don't care for much. No, I dropped her off at your place, left her car there, and got a ride from some girl I've never seen before. She said her and her mom just moved here from Southern California. She was just coming out of the old farm and feed shop. She saw me walking and asked if I needed a ride. So I accepted, and here I am.
I didn't hear half of what you just said. Everything came to a screeching halt right after the whole someone I love part. You care to explain that a little more?
Yeah, in a minute. So this girl pulls up and asks me if I want a ride. And she said she and her mom just moved here.
A new girl and her mom, huh? How old was this girl?
Well, far be it from me to ask a woman her age, but my first guess would be maybe mid-20s.
Does this young lady have a name?
Well, I'm sure she does. Doesn't everybody?
You mean you didn't ask?
Oh, you mean actually open up my mouth and form a question similar to who on earth are you? You mean that?
Yeah, that.
Yeah, I did that.
And?
And what?
And what did she say, Jerry?
Whoa, okay, I'm sorry. You want to know what she said. Of course you do. How silly of me. I'm sorry, Dad. I'm just a little preoccupied in the heart and mind right now. Her name is Lenden.
Lenden? Now there's a name you don't hear every day. Does she have a last name? And I hope to heavens it isn't England.
No, it didn't come up.
I see. I'll tell you, sometimes getting information out of you is like digging a 6-foot hole with a spoon.
I'm sorry, Dad. It's just that Emma and I had a chance to talk after we left the cabin. And after I did a bit of explaining about my concerns for her safety and well-being, she agreed to stop pursuing this whole Jed Cooper thing. And at the same time, I got a chance to share some of my history and how I was an only child and how I never had any siblings to play with and how you raised me like a son but not quite legally and how I have this deep connection with her and...
And what, Jerry?
Dad? I know it may be a bit unethical at this point in our lives, but... Would you adopt me?
Hey, while I'm out this way, I should stop by and see that new family that took over the Farnsworth property. They've been here almost a month. It's about time I pay them a visit.
No problem.
Hello, officer. Is something wrong?
No, ma'am. Not at all. I'm Captain Willis from the Brooksdale Police Department. I like to make a regular practice to meet as many of the new residents as I can. I started noticing activity here last month. I would have been here a lot sooner, but my schedule's been so chaotic, I just haven't had the chance to stop by till now.
Oh, that's perfectly all right, Captain. Truth be told, I've been so busy getting this place set up and organized and running around, getting ourselves connected to the community, and it was probably better that you didn't stop by until now.
Yeah, you're probably right about that. So what's your name?
I'm Sloan Thatcher.
Where did you move here from?
My daughter, Lenden, and I moved up here from Los Angeles.
Los Angeles? Wow, then this is quite a change for you. I can only imagine the culture shock you must be going through.
Well, actually, it's a welcome change for us. We just got so sick and tired of city life, we needed an extreme change. We wanted to find some place quiet where things move a little slower and aren't so hectic.
Well, you couldn't have picked a better place than here, that's for sure. Is your daughter here?
No, she went to the farm and feed store up the road to get some more cornmeal for the chickens.
Oh, well, I'm sorry I missed her. So how are you adjusting to things?
Actually, very nicely. I think one of the most noticeable things for us is how friendly everyone is. Most people in L.A. pretty much keep to themselves and hardly even look you in the eyes. But people around here are open and friendly and even offer to help. Last week I was hauling groceries in the back of our truck and I hit a bump and two bags went flying out the back all over the road. I thought for sure I'd have to pick it all up myself, but the very first person driving by actually stopped to help. I was very impressed.
Well, that's one thing about some of these small communities. They're just a different mindset with people. They're relaxed, they're not in a rush, and they just tend to be more friendly overall.
That's one of the things that we noticed when we got here. I think the other was how few cars were lined up at the stoplight in town when I pulled up to it. I think there were only four. Boy, in L.A., you're lucky if there's less than 50 in a line.
Yeah, around here, anything more than seven is considered a traffic jam.
They better be careful. They might be late to work.
Yeah, not much chance of that. Well, I better get going. It was a pleasure to meet with you. I've got a pile of paperwork back at the department to catch up on.
It was a pleasure to meet you too, Captain.
All righty then. You have a good day.
You too, Captain.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Brooksdale, 15 miles. Well, not too far to go now. From what Jerry tells me, this professor he works for is quite a character. I hope I get along good with him, and I can't wait to start interacting with the Grassman there, or Sasquatch as they call it. That's something that's going to take a while to get used to. Another thing that's going to take a while is getting used to a whole new group of them. Building new relationships, getting to know their territory, their habits. It's going to be like the first day of school all over again. But it's better than the alternative. Staying in that ash heap back home would have been the end of me. At least here I get to be with them again, and I get to work with other people who will understand me. And I wonder if... Oh my god! There's one right in the middle of the road!
Excuse me, just passing through. Welcome to your new home. We've been waiting for you,
What? Now there's a thought transfer I never thought I'd hear. Is that a good omen or what?
Hey, Lenden.
Yeah, Mom?
You want to watch a movie tonight?
Sure. I just need to sweep off the front porch first. The wind blew leaves all over the place out there, and it's a mess.
That's the third time this week this happened. You know, if we could have a screen built around that porch, we wouldn't have to sweep it at all.
Now, there is a brilliant idea. I wish we would have thought of that a month ago.
A month ago, we were still trying to organize this place. Not to mention, I was neck high in divorce papers.
Yeah, true. Well, I suppose I could ask around. I'm sure somebody around here must know how to build a screen wall.
So what kind of movie would you like to watch?
I don't know. How about one of those monster movies?
Really?
Oh, hey, I know. Remember that one that Uncle Frank likes so much? The one about Bigfoot? What was it called? Mountain Monster or something like that?
Oh, yeah. I remember that one, where he ripped the door right off the barn and all the chickens went crazy. We used to sit there and try so hard to hold our laughter in because it was all so stupid.
Boy, Uncle Frank didn't seem to think so. He believed every word of it.
Well, your Uncle Frank believes a lot of things.
Yeah, and Bigfoot seemed to be at the top of his list. But it's also far-fetched. I mean, can you imagine some 8 to 10 foot hair-covered creature just roaming around the woods, ransacking people's barns and scaring all their animals? A fox? Maybe. But Bigfoot? What a joke. And to make it all sound so real. I mean, come on. How could something like that really exist in today's modern world?
Do you still want to watch it?
Yeah, sure. I could use a good laugh. Hey, I better get this porch swept off before the wind starts blowing again. If it blows any harder next time, we could both end up in Oz.
Okay. I'll set up the movie. See you in a minute, Dorothy.
Ha ha. Very funny. What on earth is going on in the barn? All it takes is one to start the conversation, and pretty soon every single one of them are in on it. What is that? Oh my god, two of our chickens are dead. But how did they... What the H-E double toothpicks is going on in there? I'll tell you, if there is a fox in this barn, I swear I...